Well, this knife that we see here is in a display about dining in the gallery, which is all about how people lived and what sort of possessions they had in their houses. And as you see, it's a rather splendid knife. And we are not actually entirely sure what it was used for. Part of the design suggests that it was used for cutting meat. It has a fairly sharp blade, but the width of it suggests that it may have been used to present meat. You offered a slice of meat that you'd carved to a diner. And of course, this little point at the end here, you see, would have been used also to pick up a slice of meat. So we don't know. And then, of course, the engraving on it is very unusual. You see here, it has musical notation on one side and on the other. So if you turned it, it works rather well. And this is a part for one singer, and there would have been other knives with other parts for other singers. And how was this used? Did people pick up their knife and sing a little and then turn it over and sing a little again and then use it? Because of course diners in very grand feasts didn't cut their own meat. They had squires to cut it for them. It was a specialised job with its own rules and its own sort of own status. It was quite an important job. So it's a bit of a mystery.
The V&A has this wonderful knife that I first came across in a book about 10 years ago and thought, what an extraordinary object. And then when I went to work at the V&A, I obviously went to look at it and wanted to find out more about it, and always wondered if it was part of a larger set, because it's got one voice part name, tenor, written on it, which suggests that there might have been other voice parts. So I started to look into it and found out through the museum's records that there were indeed other examples. There are some in America, in Philadelphia. It turns out that there are some in Paris, one in a private collection in Belgium, some in the Netherlands, one in Germany. And so slowly, sort of over quite a number of years, I've been piecing together the location of these knives, getting photographs of them, and then actually starting to transcribe the music that's found on them. Obviously, I needed the images of all these knives to actually show the music on both sides, because, of course, each knife on the blade has the grace to be sung. The benediction to be sung at the beginning of a meal, and then the grace to give thanks at the end of it. And so the notation is very clear on these knives. So my background is in musicology. I have a PhD in musicology, so I was able, in early music, so I was able to write down the music and put it into a kind of modern notation that we would use today. And I've been working with the people here at the Royal College of Music, who also have great experience in this sort of thing, advising me on how to actually, write it out. And then we've been recording the actual music today, which has been fantastic.
Page 2, bar 2. Could it end quite sort of quietly? And then strong on the amen again. So the unus is quite that cadence, and then a strong ending, as you said.
Hearing the recordings being made today has been absolutely extraordinary. I mean, I've been working with these knives and longing to actually hear what they would have sounded like originally when sung from. I've bashed out this music on the piano myself, but of course that doesn't give you anything like the same indication as hearing voices perform it. So for me, it's been quite emotional, but it's also really shown me that they do function. I mean, I think there's always been a question mark as to whether or not they were actually used in context. And I think there's no question, having heard the performances today, that would have been entirely possible.